Everyone talks about radical Christianity. One's talking about the essence of Christianity itself. I think the important thing to remember is that the primary Christian story is the story of a person who died as a blasphemer, whose problem, as far as his contemporaries was concerned, was that he taught with authority, not as the scribes, that the stories that were told about him were stories told about somebody who based his convictions about God and about the coming kingdom of God on the visionary experience. And the same is true of Paul as well. Here's this person who, whatever else one says about his teaching, had pretty strong things to say about the law of Moses. And he says these things, in large part at least, because the person he believes he sees in a vision on the Damascus Road has called into a different sort of religious behavior as compared with his life as a Pharisee. So radical Christianity is at the heart of Christianity itself, and what has happened down the centuries is that various individuals have looked back, and going back to the roots is what radicalism means, and found in these New Testament stories a way of understanding their Christian faith, which has differed from the more institutional, more traditional emphasis on accepting things which are handed down and the rest of it. So that seems to me to be the heart of what it is I want to talk to you about. If one looks at the Gospels, for example, what one finds is Jesus in conflict with his contemporaries on the basis of the fact that, in a sense, he's not one of them. He is not part of that scribal elite. Added to which, he journeys to Jerusalem out of a sense of conviction, and that sense of conviction leads him into conflict with a group of priests who manage the temple and who are in relationship with the Roman occupying colonial power, whose major task was to make sure that peace and order was preserved. And then there's the other gospel, the Gospel of John, different in so many ways from the other three Gospels. But in that Gospel, what we've got is a picture of Jesus who all the time is appealing to what he has seen with his Father and uses that claim to visionary experience, what he's heard from God, as a way of understanding what it is he should be doing, even if that conflicts with what is handed down in the Law of Moses and in the teaching of the authorities of his day. The best example of radical Christianity that I can think of is a Lancashire man who found himself in London in 1649, which is the year that King Charles I was executed. And in that extraordinary period, he, like many others, found themselves with a sense that something dramatic was happening in British society. And he writes about his experience and his convictions. And in so doing, I think he offers for us exactly what it is that I'm talking about when I'm talking about radical Christianity. Here he is writing 6 months after the execution of Charles I. "Not a full year since, being quiet at my work, my heart was filled with sweet thoughts, and many things were revealed to me which I never read in books, nor heard from the mouth of any flesh. And when I began to speak of them, some people could not bear my words. And amongst those revelations, this was one, that the earth shall be made a common treasury of livelihood to whole mankind, without respect of persons. And I had a voice within me bade me declare it all abroad, which I did obey, for I declared it by word of mouth wheresoever I came. Then I was made to write a little book called The New Law of Righteousness, and therein I declared it. Yet my mind was not at rest, because nothing was acted, and thoughts run in me that words and writings were all nothing and must die. For action is the life of all, and if thou dost not act, thou dost nothing. Within a little time, I was made obedient to the word in that particular likewise, for I took my spade and went and broke the ground upon George Hill in Surrey." I think you've got it all there. You've got this sense of inner conviction, which, for when Stanley came by this inner voice. Time and time again, there is this appeal to dream, to vision, to the sense of God speaking directly, whatever one might find in the words of Scripture or in the traditions of the Church. And then, most important of all, this emphasis that Win Stanley has, that it's not just about writing theology in books, it's about action. And one can see again and again, right the way through, from what Jesus is doing when he goes up to Jerusalem to challenge those in power, right the way through to the modern examples like liberation theology, the emphasis is on action and life, and then secondarily, reflection. So when Stanley writes his new law of righteousness, he declares it, but inwardly he's not convinced that that's enough. And what he wants to do is to do something which actually marks the time in which he's living and go and dig the common ground and show that livelihood for everybody without respect of persons is something which can be enacted here and now. And he and a group did exactly that on what is now, incidentally, one of the poshest parts of southeast England on St George's Hill in Surrey. The 16th century, the Reformation, was a very turbulent period. We think of Luther and Calvin and the great reformers, but there were many others as well, Anabaptists in particular, who took a very different sort of line, emphasising the importance of ordinary people, their understanding of Scripture. The person that I would just want to concentrate on is Thomas Munzer, exact contemporary of Luther, and Luther has some pretty strong things to say about him, but they're coming out of the same general background in medieval mysticism, that sense of inward communion with God. The difference between Munzer and Luther is that Munzer didn't have powerful backers in the end among the princes of his day, and ended up dying in a struggle with the peasants in 1525 outside Frankenhausen. I think Munzer is important because he reminds us that radical Christianity often down the centuries included resort to force of arms in order to prosecute the warfare of the saints to bring about the kingdom of God on earth. It's not uniform in this sort of radicalism, but it's a form of action which I think it would be wrong to ignore. Munzer all the time was looking for opportunities to work to bring about a new situation in the lives of ordinary people in the cities in which he lived and worked. And one of the things that he did was to preach a memorable sermon called A Sermon to the Princes, in which he saw himself as a new Daniel, a Daniel who, like Daniel had with Nebuchadnezzar, was advising the princes about what it is they should be doing. And what Munzer says, you need to be taking up your arms in order to bring about the kingdom of God on earth. Munzer got involved in this and sympathized with and worked alongside peasants whose, I think one could say, legitimate demands for a better deal in their time had led them to rise in revolt against the lords in their particular area. And it was all brutally put down in 1525. Munzer was captured and eventually executed. What I think we need to remember is that, you know, what is behind this is this conviction that he was called to take up the sword and to bring about the kingdom of God on earth. It's different from what we find in the writings of Gerard Win Stanley. Win Stanley, as far as one can see, was what we would now call a pacifist. Different also from what we shall see in 20th century examples like liberation theology, where there is very little evidence of resort to force of arms. Indeed, quite the reverse, and some are explicitly pacifist in the sort of line that they take. It's nearly 30 years ago since I first went to Brazil, and I went there in my first leave of absence in Cambridge. It was a very strange story in itself. I was about to do what many others have done and gone to Germany and then to Israel for leave in order to do some writing. And a friend of mine who had just come back from Bolivia said, what are you doing that for? Why not, given your interest in political theology, go and see what's happening in Latin America? And so I did. I wrote to various people and had a remarkable time over 2 or 3 months in the summer of 1983, traveling around Brazil and to some extent Mexico, right at the end of my stay. What I discovered there was a different way of doing theology as compared with anything that I had been familiar with. I'd been in São Paulo, the largest city in Brazil, and the center, the motor of liberation theology in the Brazilian Roman Catholic Church for a couple of days. And my host took me to an occasion where there was a workshop on a Saturday, which, as it so happened, was May Day, 1983. I went into this community room in a favela, shanty town, on the fringes of São Paulo, to see three people behind a desk. A room full of chairs of men and women interacting with two of the people behind the desk. I subsequently discovered the two people with whom they were interacting were professors of Old Testament and New Testament at the Pontifical University in São Paulo. And the third person was a local bishop. He had nothing to say and just was there in solidarity with everything that was going on. My Portuguese wasn't quite good enough to follow everything that was going on, but it was good enough to understand that the topic of discussion for the day was the Book of Revelation. And it wasn't not being discussed about as a matter